Hello, everyone, and welcome to Collider Nightmares. I'm your host, Clarke Wolfe. Thank you all so much for joining us on Wednesday. We're on Wednesdays now. Wednesday. It's nice to see you. We've got a great show for you today, but first, let's go ahead and introduce the panel. To my left is Ms. Perri Nemiroff.
I think there's no better way to start your day than with a whole bunch of creepy stuff. Am I right? I think I'm right.
You're totally right. And to her left is Mr. John Schnepp.
Totally love a Wednesday nightmares.
Nightmares. Wonderful. And to my right is Mr. Mark Reilly.
I can't follow that up. That's like following Van Halen, I guess, man.
Yeah.
All right, happy Wednesday. Let's do some scary stuff, right?
That's our new theme song that we just came up with.
And destroyed immediately afterwards. It's gone.
Yeah. I don't know, it's pretty good. We might put it on an album and release it. Anyway, let's get into our fresh meat. Squish.
Delicious.
All right, so there we are. First up, now there have been a lot of updates on Jurassic World 2 over the past week, set to be directed by a Monster Calls director, J.A. Bayona. In addition to learning that production is set to begin in March 2017, Bayona was able to reveal to Coming Soon that Jurassic World 2 was, quote, a very personal film for him, adding, I think there will be plenty of myself in the film. Bayona also told Cinema Blend that while his movie would absolutely serve as a sequel to Jurassic World, it also works as Jurassic Park 5, or as part of a longer saga. Said Bayona, I think the story is looking for a connection between Jurassic World and Jurassic Park, more so than Jurassic World did. So guys, these are some pretty heavy updates, and I think we were talking about it a few weeks ago that I think most of us on this panel consider Jurassic Park to be a big old monster movie. Mm-hmm. Spielberg's big monster movie, maybe biggest since Jaws. And I want to go start out by saying that I really didn't like Jurassic World. Super really times a million did not like it.
That's quite a lot. That's times a million.
Yeah.
So could you possibly say that you hated it?
I could if I wasn't being diplomatic.
Okay.
And so I'm not going to say that I hated it, but I'll say that I super didn't like it. So what I will also say is that when Bayona came on, I mean, I love A Monster Calls. Mm-hmm. I love The Orphanage. Mm-hmm. I think he's incredibly talented. And so that started to give me some hope. And now reading that this would provide a connection between Jurassic World and Jurassic Park was honestly music to my ears. This is now making me excited for Jurassic World 2. So, Perri, I'll go ahead and start with you. Did this do anything to your opinion or your excitement level for Jurassic World 2? Were you always on board? Are you not on board?
I'm always on board because my favorite movie of all time, hands down, is Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
If you put something in that film franchise, I can't help but to be excited about it, and I'm going to watch it no matter what. And I'll probably like it to a degree. Jurassic World was not what I wanted out of that movie. However, I can't deny the fact that I enjoy it. I've seen it quite a few times since it's come out in theaters, and it's good enough. It's entertaining enough. However, what he says is what Jurassic World didn't do for me, and it's tap into not even just the original movie, but just respect what happened in the original three movies more so than it did. And yes, Jurassic World is essentially John Hammond's vision realized and an operational park, and that's obviously connected to the original material. But something about it didn't feel like the Jurassic Park sequel that I really wanted. It didn't really tap into, I don't know, the ideas. And there were so many little things that they could have put in it. You know, even the score to a point. They did have that part where I guess they enter the park and you hear that traditional fanfare, but there were so many other places where they could have roused those same feelings by weaving in the score a little more so than they did. So the fact that he's calling this Jurassic World 2 and Jurassic World and Jurassic Park 5 at the same time makes me think, yes, this could be the union that I need and I want. Like you said, J.A. Bayona can do no wrong thus far in my eyes, so having him on board, I really think this movie has a shot of being, you know, what I, a super fan, would want out of it.
Schnepp, how about you?
Well, see, I liked Jurassic World, but I only saw it once in the theater. That was enough for me. It satisfied, like, you know, the return. I liked that they opened the park, and I got to see that park active. I liked the kids in the little gyrosphere, and I thought it was fine. A couple of things, yeah, whatever, didn't work so well for me. But overall, fun, entertaining summer popcorn film. Did I want a Jurassic Park sequel necessarily after the three that I'd seen? Didn't really care, but that they were making a new one was fun enough, fun for me. Enjoyed it way more than I thought I would. Hearing that he's trying to make something that's a little bit different, because we did get basically Jurassic World is kind of like a remake of Jurassic Park, but with better technology and the park works. So now that we're moving forward, do I need to see Tyrannosaurus Rexes with machine guns? Do I need to see a half human flipper creature for a dinosaur? Or the weird scientific experiments that we've been, you know, warned about with the Jurassic Park 4, like, you know, like plot details and stuff from many years back? Maybe, maybe not. As long as it's different, that's all I care about. And it sounds like Bayona is also on the same page. He wants to move the thing forward. He wants to progress forward and make that sequel that we all kind of want to see now that we've reestablished the reboot is working and it's making money and we've got all those old fans and brand new fans. Let's move forward. So I'm happy to hear that.
You know, there's so much heart to Bayona's work, mm-hmm. I would argue. And to me, that was the thing that was missing from Jurassic World, because I think Jurassic Park, it's a very heartfelt movie. It's scary and it's an adventure, but I do think that there's a lot of heart to the film. And so, Reilly, I wanted to ask you, you know, judging by what you've seen from Bayona's previous work, do you think that that heart will sort of be maybe reinfused into the franchise?
Absolutely. J.A. Bayona can do no wrong in my eyes. The Orphanage is one of the greatest movies, horror movies of all time. I love that movie. And I love Jurassic World. I had the best time in the theater with Jurassic World. I've rewatched it a couple more times, and I'm like, and I get the criticisms, and I get there wasn't a lot of heart. And I get that there was a little bit too much. The kids kind of just got on my nerves for the maybe the second, third time I saw it. Anything this guy's going to do, though, I'm going to follow along. And Jurassic World, I mean, Jurassic Park to me is like a survival, almost horror movie in Steven Spielberg's world. And then Jurassic World is an action-adventure movie. So I like that he's going to combine it. He's going to do wonderful things with it. The best thing that can happen to this franchise is getting Bayona on it. Absolutely. He's going to put heart. He's going to put scary elements. He's even said it's going to be scarier. This is not the first time he's been talking about this. He has said, I'm going to make this scarier. And that's what I want. I want more scares, and I would love to see what he's doing. I don't think they're going to do the flipper guy and the machine guns.
Yeah, I don't think so.
That was a rumor, though. That was actually a development.
I've seen art of that, so I'm glad they're not going to do
that. Like, and there was a part of me that B-movie love and monster movies of, like, wanting to see velociraptors running in the desert with the army.
But it would
that
just would be ruin funny. It.
But it would be, at the end of the day, how can you do that? I don't know.
Well, it seems like that's what they embraced in Jurassic World, more so than the heart, because that's why the movie doesn't have any, and that was part of my problem with how it recognized the original movie. It's just, it felt like it threw in the part with them finding the building and the Jeep, whereas it didn't really feel organic and it didn't give me the chills that I thought it would.
I agree.
Yeah. Well, looks like we're all excited, so that's a good thing for the second movie. And Universal can have all of our dollars in 2018,
dollars.
I think, when it's coming out. Right. So we'll stay tuned. All right, moving on. A very different kind of scary. On Monday, the trailer for the new body horror movie Replace found its way onto Entertainment Weekly's website. And from the looks of it, Rebecca Forsyth has found herself in an unpleasant situation. From EW, Forsyth's character is Kira, and she is afflicted by a disease that causes her skin to age rapidly and crumble away. When she discovers that she can replace her skin with that of another person, Kira must choose between watching her body fall apart or given to temptation regardless of the cost. Replace also co-stars genre icon Barbara Crampton. All right, Schnepp, I'm going to start with you. I know you love you some body horror. And this movie, I had no idea this movie was a thing. I had not heard of it. But I loved this trailer. This trailer worked for me big time. So how did you feel about it?
I liked it. I mean, I love Barbara Crampton from Beyond. She's been in so many amazing films and recently a lot more. So it's cool to see her return to a lot of horror films. The trailer, definitely, I'm mixed on the trailer. I need to see the film. But what the trailer did do is its job. Now I want to see the movie. It felt very uneven and just sort of like, you know, it's called Replace, and then you have to have that line in there. What we need to do is have your body replaced with others. And I was like, all right, now I get it. But you know what I mean? It's a little on the nose, and I just want to see where it goes. You know what I mean? it set it up, but I don't know where it's going. So at least the trailer did, like I said, the job. I'm interested.
I'm actually really kind of excited about the idea, too, that a body horror movie has a female protagonist.
Totally.
Because I feel like a lot of the stuff that we have seen in the past couple of years that you could count as body horror has been very male-centric. Mm-hmm. And I like the idea of watching a young woman's body fall apart. We're going to see a lot more of that when Raw comes out next year. Oh, yeah. And there's going to be a lot of... There is going to be a lot more lady-centric body horror coming in 2017. But so I wanted to add that. But Reilly, how about you? What was your reaction to this? Did you know about the movie, and how did you feel about the trailer?
Yeah, I didn't know about the movie. I kind of echo exactly what you were feeling, Schnepp. I thought I really liked some of the visuals. I wasn't blown away. The skin stuff, though, gets me. So it kind of did the job where I'm like, I'm interested. But reading this and the show notes, I didn't get that she's replacing the skin. Oh, sure, the title's replace. But I didn't get that she was going to maybe, that the horror angle on it. I know it's gross and she's peeling her skin off, she's falling apart. But I didn't get that she's going to then grab people's skins. I know it's in there. I know it's in the trailer, but it didn't land with me. I was like, okay. I got it more reading this. It seemed more artsy. I almost said artsy fartsy. Sorry. but it did. It seemed a little bit more on the more independent side, where it's not really horror or thriller. It's more kind of like in your imagination, you're filling in a lot of the blanks. So I wanted some skin. I wanted some like real, like, give it to me. Like, I want to see her rip skin off of somebody and put it on her body. But that might be in the movie and save for the movie without the trailer and ruining it. But it just didn't land with me as well as maybe it did for you, Clarke.
Interesting. All right, Perri, how about you?
I kind of just want a horror movie called Artsy Bartsy right now. I feel like we can come up with some pretty gnarly body horror with that.
I just wrote it, like, right now.
Please
it's
do.
All ready
Please
to
do.
Go.
I'm behind it. I'll produce it right
Let's
now.
Let's do it. All right.
I've actually seen a couple. I'm wondering now if you've seen some female-centric body horror movies, like Contracted. Mm-hmm. Recently, IFC Midnight released that. That's a good one. But I think that this is dangerous territory. I do enjoy some body horror, but of course with body horror there's always the risk of not justifying it and making it really off-putting, like torture porn. It's the same kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I saw a movie, not to review another movie while we're talking about this, but one called Excess Flesh at a film festival recently. That's another female-centric body horror movie, and I found it off-putting. Certain things about it were commendable, but overall I found it very off-putting, and I'm a little nervous that this could fall that way, given the content. However, in just assessing this trailer, I really liked it. I like the color palette of the movie. I like the tone of the movie. And I just like the way that this trailer was structured, where, you know, it starts off, and I think it's one way. I just referenced Excess Flesh and Contracted, and those were the two movies that came to my mind. I'm like, oh, another one of this. And then all of a sudden, it does add that little twist. It's a skin effect I haven't really seen before. And you could see also, the trailer isn't just about, oh, look at this creepy thing she's going to do with her skin. It's about, look at this girl who's going to have to sacrifice, I'm assuming, her morals and everything she believes in order to survive. Mm-hmm. And that intrigues me. So at this point, I think I kind of want to see it.
Yeah, I also like the metaphor of her literally falling apart. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think that's interesting. But again, we've only seen one trailer. I did some research on it. There's not a whole lot of information on IMDb. There's not a whole lot of information anywhere else. So we'll just have to stay tuned. But
I was going to add, definitely see Starry Eyes, because that's a very good recent body horror film that really goes the distance. So
you're right. That's a great recommendation. And it is. It's a female-centric body horror movie. You are right. That is correct. But yeah, well, I like that we're a divided panel on this. I think that's interesting. All right, well, we'll keep our eyes out. And from one very artsy-fartsy movie to another, last week, Don Mancini gave hope to horror fans looking for more from Chucky, the artsy-fartsiest of franchises.
Yep.
So everyone's favorite good guy, Chucky, might be back, and Mancini clued us in by way of a cryptic tweet. Could Chucky 7 be on the way, and will it feature a franchise reunion? So Bloody Disgusting has begun to put the pieces together after Mancini shared a photo of himself outside the house where the curse of Chucky took place, with the caption that reads, Chucky is finally coming home, and tags Fiona Dourif, Summer H. Howell, Jennifer Tilly, and original Andy, Alex Vincent. Could Mancini be informally confirming that Chucky 7 is getting close to production, or or could he just be pulling our legs? Schnepp is cracking up. He's not very excited about Chucky 7. What are you laughing at?
Sorry. Just that photo. Like all the nerds. Like, it's the original home. It's like, relax. Who cares, really? But it's just like seven people. It's the original home from Curse of Chucky. That's what's making me laugh. Just the four or five nerds who are freaking out about that photo.
But I will say, those four or five nerds tweet at me every week saying, can you talk about the Chucky franchise?
Chucky's original home.
Well, here we are. And so while Schnepp composes his thoughts, I'm going to come to Mark Reilly.
All right,
Reilly. So what do you think Mancini is trying to say? Now, he's been at the helm of the last three films. And I don't know. I mean, it is kind of interesting that all the way from the first movie, you've got Alex Vincent, who may or may not be involved.
Yeah.
I don't know. Is this any at all exciting to you, or should the nerds calm down?
I like the idea of bringing back the original Andy. Is that what, right?
Oh, yeah.
Was that his?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
I really like that idea. I think he's going forward with this. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's not going to go stand out in front of the house and put it on Twitter. He's teasing us. And mm-hmm. this is great. This is a great use of social media. That's what we're doing in nowadays. And look, Chucky is an icon. Mm-hmm. And they're going to make another Child's Play. If they're making money, they're going to make another one. I know some of these, they haven't landed with me. I actually haven't seen a lot of them. I know there's a lot more than I mean, I think I stopped at part three. So, great.
The Bride of Chucky is amazing.
Bride of Chucky I need to see because I do like the horror comedy. Mm-hmm. Every time I see the commercials or with Jennifer Tilly and mm-hmm. the dolls, I just giggle. But it never was enough to get me to watch the movies because I just couldn't wrap my head around. It turned into, like, the first Child's Play is fantastic.
I love it.
It's creepy as all hell. So, but when it finally got to, like, we got dueling dolls here, he put a spirit of his girlfriend into the other doll, and then they started moving forward with the franchise, you lost me, unfortunately. However, if they're bringing back the original Andy, then I'm wondering what that means. I'm intrigued. I'm gonna give me a trailer. But to answer your question, I think he's definitely moving forward with this.
Yeah, I'm wondering if they actually have a green light or if this is to encourage a production company to actually put forward the money to see what kind of response they're getting. I know that Mancini is the executive producer of Channel Zero on Sci-Fi, which we've talked about on this show, which had its season finale last night, but we can't talk about it right now. Sorry. So I'm wondering if he's trying to, like, get buzz going. What do you think, Perri?
I'm trying to figure it out. I don't follow him on Twitter, so it's tough to gauge what he actually uses his feed for and what kind of, you know, what he typically says, because that would be able to help us put this in perspective more, whether this is just something that he does or whatnot. But, you know, the thing has 500 likes and 208 retweets at the moment. I don't know if that necessarily screams feature film budget, but...
It is the real Don Mancini, not the false Don Mancini on Twitter.
So that makes all the difference.
I'm glad that they're doing it because I know they're going to get Brad Dourif to play Chucky, at least the voice of Chucky. And a fun fact, when they were actually shooting the original Chucky, I was in my very first dorm in college, and it was right across, right down on the L tracks. They were taking over this restaurant called The Sequel and made it that toy with all the Chucky dolls. And we were shooting bottle rockets at the crew, and they never knew who it was because we were on the 9th floor. And we were just, like, really kind of accosting the crew for the entire time. It was a lot of fun.
I wonder if there's a DVD extra with someone talking about that. And you could be like, that was me.
I certainly hope so.
Also, there's a guy that's ready to come get you now that it's out there. He's just like, whoop.
All of a sudden, seven Chuckies show up. Like, well, we're talking about doing a commentary. I think we should do a commentary on one of these Chuckies.
Well, I think you guys should chime in and let us know if you would watch a commentary, because we can't do commentaries unless you watch them.
Yeah.
So you got to tell us if you're going to watch a Chucky commentary. And if you will,
make me want to because I've seen most of the Chucky movies. Child's Play is the only one that I've seen countless times where I will watch and rewatch it. But all, like, I've seen Bride of Chucky and I remember it being fun, but I haven't rewatched it since the first time I watched it. And I know this franchise also has a really fun lore, so it would kind of be a good thing to sit down and marathon.
Yeah, hey. I'd be on board with that. I'd be on board with that. All right. Well, from one very artistic thing to another artistic endeavor.
How many times can we say artsy fartsy in one episode?
So many, because we're talking about so many artsy fartsy things, like this new crazy movie that Anthony Hopkins is in. So when you put Anthony Hopkins and Jeffrey Dean Morgan and Colin Farrell together, some would say you've assembled a pretty solid cast of actors. Add them to what was supposed to be the sequel to David Fincher's Seven, and you have yourself an interesting cinematic prospect. Lionsgate released a trailer for the supernatural serial killer movie Solace, which sees Hopkins as a psychic doctor working with Morgan's FBI agent to track down a dangerous serial killer played by Farrell, who also has psychic abilities. Now, while the premise might sound a little goofy, the cast is filled with heavy hitters, and morbid curiosity has me interested in what was originally slated to be written into the sequel to Seven, appropriately titled 8, which would have starred Stranger Things 11. Okay, I made that part up, but still.
Oh man, that would have been kind of amazing.
Right? Okay, so this movie, I gotta say, I don't know what it was about this trailer, but I was kind of like, I kind of want to see this. I don't know why. It's gonna have a theatrical release in December and a VOD release around the same time as well. For some of you guys who are gonna do your homework, the movie has been sitting on the shelf for a while. However, it's not because the studio was embarrassed by it or anything like that. It's actually because it was a Relativity film, and when Relativity went bankrupt, it sat on the shelf, and then it got sold to another, Warner Brothers had it, and then Relativity bought it, and then now Lionsgate has it. So that's the reason why. Okay, so Perri, let's start with you. You've got psychic Anthony Hopkins and serial killer Colin Farrell with also psychic abilities. How do you not want to watch this movie?
I would much rather continue watching The Walking Dead, Westworld, and go see Fantastic Beasts. There, I've got my fix. I can skip this movie. Yeah, I don't like this trailer. I like everyone involved. If anything, that might have me the slightest bit curious, but this was a very confusing, oddly formatted trailer that does not convey the details of this crazy situation in a very appealing manner. And who is that? Abby Cornish?
Yeah, Abby Cornish.
I don't know. She looks like, I don't know what she's doing in this, but she looks like she's like super tight, but I'm going to be a lady cop, Yeah. I don't know. Just, there are so many things in this trailer that kind of just rubbed me the wrong way. And like you did, I was looking back, and it's like, not only has this thing been sitting on the shelf for a long time, but Anthony Hopkins was attached in 2011, and then someone else, Colin Farrell, didn't join the production until 2013. I don't know. Something about that just screams, this thing had issues right from the day we tried to make it. So I don't know. Well, I don't think this is going to be great anyway, but I probably won't watch it.
All right, fair enough. Well, Schnepp, so first I want to get your thoughts on the trailer, but I also wanted to ask, how do you think that you have this kind of cast sign up for something that sounds so crazy? Because I feel like the idea of a psychic detective tracking down a psychic serial killer.
Right.
It's like, I mean, that's up front. That's the premise. So how do you get this cast to sign on?
If they called it Dead Zone versus Scanners, I would probably go watch this movie. Yeah. But after I watched the trailer, and I'm like, yo, Don Mancini, can't wait to see that Chucky movie, son, because I don't care about this one. I'm way more excited to see a Chucky 7, 8, 9 than this looks like, it sat on a shelf for a reason. And because they didn't know what to do with it, and they cut a trailer, and the trailer is not really telling me anything to go see it. It's like, yes, there's some half-baked scenes that involve some weird deaths, and that was probably culled from the movie 8. They were like, just leave it as is. We don't know what to do. It feels very kind of all over the place. I mean, even that last line from Anthony Hopkins, I felt like I was watching him as the Wolfman again. Like,
yes.
He's like, how did I get in this movie? I'm going to stare off somewhere and say something semi-poignant with this garbage script. It just felt, everything about it felt off. So maybe you'll find some solace in not seeing it.
Oh, boy. Well, so Reilly, you've been over here giggling this whole segment. But also, I just want to bring up the idea that, and look, it's hard to find a lot of information about this, but we do know that this was developed as a sequel to Seven, where Somerset would have developed psychic powers.
Oh, boy.
Of course that did not happen.
This is almost as bad as when Gladiator 2 was like, he's after death and then he's traveling through time. And you're like, you mean the Gladiator movie with Russell Crowe, that awesome movie, the sequel is going to have him being a time traveler from outer space? You know,
yeah. That's crazy.
So, Reilly, I mean, what do you, okay, so I'm going to guess you're not on board with Solace.
No. You know, I when I read this and I did some research, you know, not only was it a sequel to Seven, but it was also a shared universe with Silence of the Lambs.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, I mean,
because that's how ridiculous that sounds. Then you put it in here and you go, yeah, that could work. Because totally. Somerset develops psychic powers. I mean, thank God they didn't do that.
Yeah.
I get, and that's where I take what you said, Perri, where it kind of seemed like it was falling apart at the beginning. It seems like they had the script for the sequel to Seven, right? Then they go, well, nobody wants to come back, so we're going to, you know, add some psychic powers. But then you say Somerset developed psychic powers? How in the hell did that happen? I mean, with a gritty, down-to-earth, realistic Seven movie, you know, you don't just sprout psychic powers because you did traumatized watching your partner kill somebody. I don't know. So, no, I'm not. This movie is ridiculous.
I've got a pitch for what happened the series.
Sure.
Eight.
No.
What happened to Eight? Oh. Let's get to the bottom of what happened to Eight.
There's too much I don't care involved in that.
I care, John Schnepp.
Apparently, this thing came out overseas, and there's a whole lot of negativity. Oh, my God.
Oh, boy.
It's like, I don't want to revert to a Rotten Tomato score, but even just reading the blurbs, I can't even begin to tell you how many times the word boring comes up, and this one calls it depressing, tedious, and cold.
All right.
Ooh.
Well, a great sell there.
Unfortunately, there is no solace in that. So let's go ahead and move on to our, speaking of Seven,
right.
Let's move on to...
What's in the box?
I didn't even plan that segue, but that kind of is very appropriate.
Yeah.
I take solace in that. Okay.
Ooh.
So
that's our new thing.
Yeah.
We have solace. To, yeah, definitely.
So we often say truth is stranger than fiction, and in this case, probably more terrifying. HBO dropped the trailer for their documentary, Beware the Slender Man, the true story of 12-year-olds Morgan Geyser and Nissa Weir, who lured their best friend into the woods, stabbed her 19 times, and then confessed that they did it to appease a tall and faceless man known online as the Slender Man. The haunting film plunges deep down the rabbit hole of their actions, exploring how the dark corners of the internet can influence society's most impressionable young consumers of the media. Directed by Irene Taylor Brodsky, Beware the Slender Man premieres on HBO on January 23rd, 2017. So this documentary has screened a handful of times at a couple of festivals. I've been hearing that it's very upsetting, it's really disturbing. And HBO, they did one on the man in Southern California who the Night Stalker. Do you know what
Ramirez?
I'm talking about?
Ramirez?
No.
That's San Francisco.
I'm going off script, and this is why I shouldn't do that. But anyway, they've done a handful of documentaries about true crime, and they've all sort of been pitched as horror-centric, and they are the real-life horrors of what happens. And I think this is really interesting because the idea here is that we're presented with is that these girls believed that the Slender Man was real, and they believed that they were, apparently when they were found, the two girls who did the stabbing, they were found far off looking for the Slender Man's mansion, like looking for his house to sort of go tell him what they had done. It's fascinating, and it's also very scary. So, Schnepp, let's start with you. I mean, this type of document, you're a documentarian yourself. What do you think about this so far?
Well, I mean, the trailer was interesting. It got me hooked. I want to know more. I remember hearing about this, and then, of course, hearing about the Slender Man and all the creepypasta stories. Like, I guess for me, I don't know if the creepypasta stories came first and these girls read about it online.
Yes.
Is that what happened?
Yeah.
And then they kind of like, they just started imagining themselves seeing it and talking about this character, and it became real to them. And I mean, it's pretty frightening. I mean, it goes back. It makes me think about, you know, the kids who were like listening to heavy metal and were like, the devil told me to do this stuff. And we heard, you know, Satan's words or whatever. And it's really, they're making the stuff up. So I don't know. I mean, I'm definitely interested in seeing the documentary for sure.
Yeah. And, you know, Reilly, as I said in the notes, like, you know, truth is stranger than fiction. Like, we have that conversation all the time. But this is true life horror. This is real horror. And it's based on fictional horror, which I think is complicated in and of itself.
Yeah. I mean, God, it looks fantastic. And in a weird way, I know people are saying now it's disturbing. And yeah, because look at some of those images of just like the Slenderman. I mean, he looks freaky. I mean, it looks like a scary movie. And then when you take the actual true life of this, it boggles my mind. I'm a huge fan of true crime documentaries, like Making a Murderer. I mean, I just binged the hell out of that. And I've been listening to Serial podcasts and then this undisclosed podcast about the follow-up of that case. I love all these stuff, and I'm going to watch this. I mean, there is nothing that's going to stop me from watching this. It looks so fascinating. And to just juxtapose the true horror of an actual fictional thing, and to think that they're walking around looking for this guy's mansion, I mean, it's just like, oh, God, it makes me sick to my stomach thinking about that this is our world. Did they think that this guy was real? And that, I mean, that's probably going to be answered, maybe not, but yeah, I'm in. I mean, what can I say? Whew.
Yeah, the documentary I was referring to that HBO did was Tales of the Grim Sleeper.
Mm. Oh, that serial killer.
Yeah.
The Grim Sleeper. Yeah.
Which is more
that
so...
That was an LA one. Yeah.
Yes, and what's interesting about that is that's actually more about class and poverty and the legal system, which you know is interesting because it's sort of wrapped in this horrible true crime outside. And then the Cheshire Murders is another absolutely horrifying HBO documentary that is true crime. But I mean, these are real things. And you know, I wanted to also mention for you guys that don't know, Creepypasta. You know, I don't actually know if Slenderman was a proper creepypasta, but it was a community sourced and built urban legend. So these are urban legends that are not based in fact, and they're not actually based on real historical urban legends. They are created on the internet, and they live on the internet, and these communities, there are thousands of creepypastas, including Candle Cove, which we're watching on Sci-Fi. So I just wanted to mention that as well. So Perri, you know, when you first heard about this, the story and the documentary, what are your reactions?
I was so, so upset that I missed this at South by Southwest because it's hard to explain in a way that I think makes sense, but there's obviously something deeply disturbing and upsetting about the true story. At the same time, especially as presented in this trailer, it's like that trailer wrapped up, and there's part of me that just thought, I need to see more of this. It's that push and pull where I don't want to think about it because it's so disturbing, but at the same time, I need to see the full thing. And you know, I was at South By and I missed it, and a bunch of people that I know that saw the movie, you know, said very positive things about it, just in terms of the quality of the film, and also how the film itself doesn't necessarily portray the girls as, oh, girls bad, they did a terrible thing. It really does explore both sides and why they might have slipped into this mentality and what drove them to do this, which I think is going to make the documentary even more upsetting probably, and probably a better film for it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm under the impression that this is not an exploration of their guilt or innocence. Mm-hmm. It's more about how young minds or minds of people can be sort of indoctrinated and actually believe that this stuff is true. It's absolutely fascinating. And by the way, the young lady who was stabbed survived. So that is, if there is a silver lining here, it's that she was not killed. So Beware the Slender Man premieres on HBO on January 23rd, 2017. And finally, this week, Teen Wolf showrunner Jeff Davis was able to give updates on both his pilot for a potential series adaptation of the Swedish novel Let the Right One In at TNT, as well as his involvement with MTV's adaptation of H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds. Speaking with Forbes.com Merrill Barr, Davis spoke to the War of the Worlds, noting that it's, quote, not like Independence Day, where it's a huge sci-fi, massive special effects extravaganza. It's more POV from the ground up, with survivors desperately trying to figure out how to stop this alien invasion and occupation. occupancy. Davis compared the project to a Michael Crichton-type thriller and praised Steven Spielberg's War of the Worlds as underrated, which I would tend to agree with. And switching gears, Davis then sang the praises of his cast leading the pilot for Let the Right One In, noting that while he loves the original Swedish film, it wasn't until he read the book that he realized how the story could be a TV series because, as he stated, quote, it's the story of Renfield. It's Dracula's seduction, the way he brings in Renfield the caretaker. Mm. That's a very interesting POV, and to tell it from the eyes of kids, it's a very adult story. It's quite dark. We'll see if it gets past the pilot stage. Davis concluded by stating that TNT would be deciding if Let the Right One In would be going to series, quote, pretty quickly. Okay, so Perri, let's start with you. I mean, first of all, if we hearken back to when we talked about the War of the Worlds series on this show, it sounds like their take on it is kind of exactly what we were expecting, right? More of a personal story. But does this news excite you? Because I have to say, I kind of, any reservations or hesitations I might have had about these projects, the networks, adapting the material, whatever, I'm kind of on board.
I think both have me excited. You know, when you're basing something on previous material, it's hard not to find little concerns where things could go wrong. But in terms of War of the Worlds, I'm kind of happy it's going to MTV. I feel like that's the way to do it, where it's going to make the tone feel a little different. And also, given what they're doing with Scream, I can almost envision it working for the MTV audience kind of well. And, you know, you compare something to Michael Crichton, and I'm going to rah-rah. I love the sound of that. For Let the Right One In, I think that one has me a little more nervous because I'm a little more attached to both the original and the remake. I like both quite a bit. And the thought of them saying, okay, I like the Renfield part. That is what has me intrigued. And if you focus solely on that, I think this thing has the potential to be something very special. However, then when he says it's a very adult story, it's quite dark, I'm like, oh, like the other ones, you know? Mm. So yeah. I'm curious to see how these two things develop. He says it right there, of course, you know, for Let the Right One In, a pilot is just a selling tool. Who knows if it'll ever get the order to go to series, but I certainly hope I get to see it one way or the other. I guess if it doesn't get picked up, I'll never see the pilot, but I would like to. I'm curious. I think both of these things have potential, so I'm rooting for them.
Yeah, I think we all need to read this book. I mean, not that we have time to read Let the Right One In or read any books. I wish I did, but, well, we'll get to that later. But, Reilly, how about you? I mean, how are you feeling? Still a skeptic?
Yeah. I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying.
I did so well on all the reading today, too.
I didn't want to say anything.
Still skeptical? How
are you feeling? Yes, I am. But I find it interesting that I can actually like both things that he talks about and then put it into my mind that he talks great things about War of the Worlds. It sounds like your average what you expect from an apocalypse movie, be it zombies or aliens. Ground level stuff, not the big spectacle of Independence Day. I get all that. Right. But then when you put it, for me, on MTV, I can't see it. I can't see it. Because I've seen Scream, I saw the pilot, didn't like it. Teen Wolf didn't really get into it either. Maybe I saw the pilot, so maybe I'm judging it too unfairly. But MTV just doesn't seem to land with me. So, and that's just me. Who cares? So if I hear great things, it's a great spin on it. But what I said was I wanted to see the Tim Robbins in the basement of the Spielberg movie. I want that War of the Worlds. And I don't think MTV can give me that because it's a different mandate. They're going to be looking to cast it up and put some really interesting, I want to say pretty people in there.
Hot
and
teenagers.
This is an apocalyptic alien invasion world. So you're not going to get that. You're not going to be able to look as perfect as you would want to. So I'm worried about that with MTV. However, now let's go over to Let the Right One In. TNT, totally behind this. I go, yep, I love what he says about Dracula's seduction told through the kid's point of view. I love that. I love the two movies, the remake and the original. So this gets me more excited. So it's interesting to see him say really wonderful things and then put one in MTV and go, nope, and the other on a different network and go, okay.
Well, that's the thing with MTV, though. It's like MTV has their audience.
Yeah.
So I can understand why you wouldn't go for their version, whereas I, for some reason, seem to be a sucker for Scream and some of their other series, too. But, by putting it on MTV, you do close the door to many longtime fans.
And I can see how Scream works there. You know, I really, like, when they announced Scream to be on MTV, I went, yep, that makes a lot of sense to me, and I watched it. But it just didn't land with me. But, yeah, War of the Worlds just doesn't feel like an MTV thing for me. That's just me, though.
Schnepp?
I still can't get over the idea of even saying, well, I'm going to watch something on MTV. So,
right?
You know, it's like, I thought it was for music videos, right? It's been dead for years. I actually like the idea of War of the Worlds. I don't care if it's on MTV or whatever. I won't watch it on MTV anyway. I'll watch it on some streaming service. So it doesn't matter to me what any of these shows are on any channel. I could care less. To me, the idea of it, though, even if it is kids as survivors trying to find out how are they going to survive after the alien invasion, because that's what this is about, is it's about the survivors. So I can very much see that scenario that you're talking about in this series, whether or not it's a Tim Robbins type character, maybe it's a group of kids going from house to house trying to survive, very much like Walking Dead. I could see that as a very cool, fun adventure, not only for the MTV audience, but for general audiences like even myself, if I think about it from that perspective. So whether it's going to be like that or not, who knows? But I think that series has way more potential, at least from reading about it, than to let the right one in, because I love the concept and the idea that he's explaining as from the POV of Renfield, like seeing how that character got drawn in to be, you know, slavish towards the master by being suckered in to take care of this vampiric creature and be its shepherd. I mean, that sounds fantastic. How are they going to get away with that in this very dark tone? That's very much, both of the films are very dark.
Yeah.
I don't see it on TNT, or, you know, I don't see them taking that risk. I think they're talking that game. They're like, let's flex and do a bunch of cool stuff. It's not going to happen. They're going to get to that pilot and they're going to lose the nuts. They're going to forget. No, we can't do that. Mm-hmm. Who's going to watch it? Hopefully I'm wrong. I'd love to be wrong because I want to see both series.
Mm-hmm.
But honestly, for me, the one that sounds like it's going to actually go to series is War of the Worlds.
Yeah, I think that that's probably an accurate production, but time will tell.
Yeah.
And from one apocalypse to another, it's time for our monster of the week. Indeed. So I don't know about you, but I've been a little stressed lately.
Why, Clarke? It's weird.
Yeah, it's so weird. I don't
so
know.
Strange.
Last week has been very stressful.
Monster of a week.
And so on Sunday night, I found myself slowing down, taking deep breaths, and thinking, okay, what can I do to relax? And the answer I came up with was to read Stephen King's It. Now, I know that this doesn't sound like the most relaxing thing on the surface, as anyone familiar with the horrifying deeds of Pennywise can tell you, children getting their heads ripped off and such things. But I thought about the idea of a controlled environment in which to experience fear and anger and aggression or whatever. And I thought about the plot of a bunch of outsiders like banding together to fight for something. And that made me calm down a little. And I think we often, horror fans are often fighting the fight of, like, you know, when people say, oh, you know, horror movies make you bad, or scary movies make you do bad things. When most horror fans would say, well, no, it's actually a good, safe environment to feel the aggression. And I mean, Wes Craven talked about that a lot while he was alive. And anytime he talked about it, I thought it was very interesting. So I wanted to put it to you guys. Are there any things, movies, books, video games, music, you know, scary things that you guys have used to experience a catharsis or, you know, something of the like? Anything jumping to mind?
Oh, yeah. I have a big, it was a big emotional event in my life, you know, dealing with an ex, as one does. But it was a major life change in my life. And I got through it by reading the Walking Dead comics. I mean, that was just it. I would look forward to getting home and just I bought all the volumes. And it was going through that tumultuous time in my life. And I don't know what it was. It was just as like I knew I could disappear. And we're talking about me breaking up with somebody, zombie apocalypse. Why am I so into it? I don't know. I just think it was an escape. I love all what you wrote too, Clarke. I mean, it really is, when you could look at it like band of people working together to defeat evil. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that could fit into whatever is ailing you for that day, be it a relationship thing, something that's going on at work, the bigger picture thing, and that. So I loved what you wrote here. So that was what jumped out for me, and even just scary movies that we always talk about here. If I have a bad day, I love putting on a Friday 13th movie because I just forget about everything. It really is just an escape. That's what it always has been for me. But I love going a little deeper, which is what you want to do here. And actually, it makes so much sense for me for you reading that because I love it. I'm rereading it. Well, I'm behind now. I think you're beating me on this. But like banding together and just defeating that ultimate evil, it's just a great thing. So that's what popped to my mind.
Yeah, a very human story in a way, even though the monster, even though Pennywise is like an interdimensional demon slash monster that, you know, but anyway, I'm rambling. So how about you guys?
If I don't go with my classics like Scream and Jurassic Park, it tends to be horror comedies. Like I'll tell you, I'm not just saying Ash versus Evil Dead because we cover it here, but there's something about that show where when I turn it on, everything kind of just melts away. Mm. I focus on it. I have so much fun with it. It's got so much energy to it. And then I walk away with kind of like a little pep in my step, all happy and excited for what's to come on the show and just feeling better about whatever I might have been stressing about before. But I'm not sure if I brought this story up here or maybe on a mailbag or something, but there was one time back in New York when I was sure I was going to get a job and I was so excited about it. I thought I had it and I didn't. I didn't get it and I was like freaking crushed. It was miserable and I had no choice but to suck it up and to go to a press screening that night, and the press screening was Zombieland. Nice. I mean, I walked into that theater almost in tears, and when I walked out, I felt like a new person. Mm. I had so much fun in that movie and it made me feel great.
That's nice. A great one. Schnepp, how about you?
Yeah, cathartic films for me. I definitely The Thing. Mm-hmm. I like these transformative films where characters go through it and you don't know who's who and certain things like that. Definitely a lot of Cronenberg films for me. I love Videodrome. If I'm in a bummed out mood, because that always makes you think about like society. Look at the weird world that we live in now where everybody is in a Cronenberg movie from Videodrome, because literally everybody has like, hey, look, I got a PS4. They got these weird visors and I'm in a different dimension. It's like totally like when I see that, I'm like, I see Videodrome. It's a weird thing. Long live the new flesh. Also, I mean, I'll go and play Red Dead Redemption and just go to Thieves Landing and murder hundreds of people, and it's so cathartic and fun, and I never feel bad, and I never feel like I'm gonna go murder somebody. So I hate when people blame video games. Right. Grand Theft Auto, steal some cars, run over a bunch of people, murder innocents until the cops kill you, till I'm
dear
going
God,
down.
Let no one take any of that out of context.
Yeah, but I'm saying, I mean, that kind of stuff is like really, it's like if you've had a bummer day and you're playing a video game, that is definitely a cathartic release.
Sure.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with it as long as you got your head screwed on right. I mean, and that's the kind of thing where people will jump the gun or blame music or blame video games or blame movies or play. I mean, that's the kind of thing where you're like, that's out of touch. The people who are doing that already had those problems. Right. Look at our entire society and how most of us are just, I'd say like it's 99% are completely normal. 1% are the ones that, I heard the voices, you know. Oh, they were already hearing voices, but they just put it towards this. So definitely kill as many people as possible in video game land.
Only there.
Only
please.
There.
Collider Nightmares does not endorse killing.
Real murders.
Yeah, real murders. No. That is no bueno. Let us know. We hope that maybe these were some good, scary, fun options for you guys. And let us know if you've ever had a horror catharsis or, a scary thing has helped you get through a frustrated, impassioned time. And with that, let's move on into our Twitter questions. Tweet, 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 tweet.
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 All right. First up, Lauren G at the Nerd 117 asks, what creature / monster / entity do you think is underused in modern horror films? I want more scary aliens. Scary aliens. I could definitely afford to see some more scary aliens in my life.
Yeah.
Anything jumping to mind for you guys?
Yeah, I want to see more Sasquatch and Bigfoot movies.
Ooh.
Nice.
I want to see some real horror films done with a Yeti. Let's bring that stuff.
There is a movie called Dark Was the Night with Kevin Durand, and it's on Netflix. I wouldn't suggest watching it, but it is an attempt at a Sasquatch movie
okay.
that So you can watch it. Maybe you'll like it better than me.
All right.
I don't know. Who knows?
I'm a big fan of all the creepy legends in Iceland. There's so many great stories there that have not been put on the big screen, and it's crazy. The guy who directed that feature I produced is Icelandic, and he's got so many scripts that are just brilliant. I wish someone would kind of take the plunge and give it a shot. But one of my favorite Icelandic legends, and it's funny because when Child Eater premiered at Brooklyn Horror Film Festival, it just so happens that the short that came before it was an Icelandic one, and it was about the legend of Grýla. That's like their Christmas legend. It's a creepy lady who lives on the top of the mountain, and she comes and like she puts like bad children in her sack and then goes back off the mountain and cooks them and eats them.
Delicious.
And she's got an evil cat and something like 12 children who also do terrible things in the town. It's just, I mean, really. Go look up Grýla and then just go explore all Icelandic legends.
October 30th, 2018.
I'm a little sad I did not grow up in Iceland because I would have been a very happy child there.
A very happy, terrified child.
Damn right.
Riley, how about you?
I'm a big fan of just monster movies in general.
Yeah, me too.
So I would love just monster movies. I can't wait to see Monster, Brian Bertino's movie, and I can't wait to see A Monster Calls. I think we're getting a resurgence of these monster movies. But yeah, scary aliens, give them to me. I want more of those. I love Alien, obviously, and we'll see how Alien Covenant turns out. But yeah, I think anything with just some kind of monster, if you can create a mythology around it, if it can show up somewhere like it seems the monster is doing, I love those.
I'm glad you brought up Alien Covenant because I cannot wait for that movie.
It sounds great.
Actually really
everything
like
sounds really
so
great.
Like, man,
I love Prometheus.
I like Prometheus too.
Yeah.
And I'm down for new monsters like Candle Cove, which we mentioned, which we talked about on the premiere here on Nightmares. The Tooth Child.
Creepy.
I mean, that's awesome. Yeah. Like that's really scary and cool. And the Creeper from Jeepers Creepers. I mean, I like the mythology built around him. I like what he looks like. I like new monsters. Mm-hmm. I think they're cool. But to answer her question more specifically, werewolves. But I think werewolves are very hard to do. Mm-hmm. I think they're really hard to do in a modern context.
I just want to see swearwolves.
Swearwolves. You know, it's the sequel is Werewolves.
Yes.
And it's coming soon. All right. Next up, Frankie Segura says, rewatched Final Destination. I get goosebumps still when Carter asks, then who's next? What's your favorite ending scene? I guess this goes without saying that we're going to talk about the end of some movies here.
Yeah.
So maybe spoilers. I don't
know.
We'll put it up just in case. We won't put that up. But so listen to me and maybe spoilers. I'll start and say one of my favorite things is the end of Drag Me to Hell because it's so effed up.
Yeah.
It's so tragic. It ends on a huge swell of action and then boom, titles and the music. And same with Insidious. Mm. Is that yours?
I love the title. No, but like when you were explaining it, I was picturing the title card of Insidious with that music.
I love the end of Insidious Chapter 1. Spoilers, guys. Mm. But when it just ends... Ah, there it is. Thank you.
Hey, all right.
It just ends on this perfect shot of Rose Byrne turning around. There's a gasp. I'm actually getting chills talking about it. There's a gasp, and then... You know, Joe Bechera's like crazy, strings.
So
this is me playing the violin, by the way. In case you're wondering what this is, what am I doing? And then the title, Insidious. It's just like, it's so freaking, those movies rule. Okay.
Yeah.
I nerded out a little bit. Anyway, who's next?
I'll go. All right. One of my favorite endings of all time happens to be from my favorite horror movie of all time, Halloween.
Uh-huh. Mm.
The original. I love how, I mean, is that the boogeyman, as a matter of fact, it was, and he's gone.
Yeah. Mm.
That I love because it's what Carpenter wanted to do. He's the shape. He is not human. He's the boogeyman incarnate, and he disappears after getting shot 7 times.
Yeah.
A lot of people, I do have some friends and some colleagues and some people on Twitter that are like, dude, Michael Myers would have died. He would have, and I'm like, that's not the point. Yeah. This is like something crazy, and I love that ending so much with a second can I say two?
Yeah,
I can.
Please.
I might steal somebody's.
I did too.
The Exorcist. The original Exorcist is just a wonderful ending. How the priest just takes it in and jumps out the window.
It's horrible.
Oh, it's horrible. Yeah. It just it gets you right here, and I love it all time. And those are. It makes a lot of sense. They're two of my favorite horror movies of all time. They're my favorite endings.
Back machine. The Nightmare on Elm Street, the very first one. That ending where you think it's over.
That's a great one.
The car pulls up and then it gets pulled through the. I mean, if you watch it now, the special effects are a little cheesy, but if you didn't know it was coming, what happens? I remember sitting in the theater freaking out when that happened.
So. But I still love how, because that's the dream. Doesn't it seem like you're still in a dream, obviously?
Yes.
But that's why when she goes through the little tiny window, it's
so
like,
horrifying.
It's so
horrifying. The mom is just pulled through a weird tiny window.
Yeah.
It's frightening.
Perri,
guess what I'm going with? A Final Destination movie.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we just had Eric Heiser in studio, and he wrote 5. And I think, major spoiler alert, if you haven't seen 5,
is that the
5,
most recent one?
Yes.
Okay.
5 is the one with the suspension bridge. And it so beautifully ties the events of that film back to the original.
Yes.
I never saw that coming, ever. And it does it so well where it doesn't feel forced or like a shtick. It was, it's perfect. And then just to veer away from Final Destination, Sleepaway Camp. I mean, that image of Angela... Once you see it, there is no unseeing it ever in your life. So I will never forget that.
Oh my God, that's a great one. All right, and finally, Mike Hamer writes, "Hi Nightmares crew, I love undervalued horror movies like Splinter and The Stuff. What are the best forgotten horrors? The one I picked is fairly recent. It came out in the last 20 years, but it's underseen and appreciated, and that is Frailty. Bill Paxton's film Frailty, starring him and Matthew McConaughey. I think that is a great movie, and if you've seen it, as the people who said, ooh, all in unison have, you know, most people love that film, but not a lot of people saw it, so I would definitely suggest checking out Frailty.
Nice. I'll go with, since I brought up The Exorcist, because it's Exorcist 3.
Yeah.
It's forgotten because of Exorcist, and then maybe even more forgotten because of The Heretic. Part 2 is just nonsense. Awful. It's awful. So Part 3 I love. I wish it was originally going to be stuck with the Legion title, but they needed the branding. I get it. But it's great. There's so many scary moments in that, and I really enjoy it. And, I mean, man, that scene in the hospital, you guys know what I'm talking about. So Exorcist 3.
You want to stare into the void and feel that darkness, watch Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer.
That's a great one.
I have never been able to get through that
movie. It is truly amazing horror film. And Michael Rooker, a very young Michael Rooker, pre-Yondu, experience the horror. That's what I'd say.
All right. I have to say 30 Days of Night. I love that movie. Mm-hmm. I don't understand why people don't talk about it more. It's on TV all the time, and I've watched it way too much.
I think I need to rewatch it, because I saw it in the theater, and I remember not liking
it. It's really dark and violent.
I need
and
to see it again.
Like, a lot of fun, if that makes any sense.
It's more fun now than when it first came out and I saw it. I didn't like it, and then I recently saw it about a year ago and actually liked it.
Yeah, I'm firmly addicted to it. Also, I think more people need to be talking about The Loved Ones. Just because he's a fantastic director and The Devil's Candy is coming up. So I just wish more people were talking about that. And one last one, Frozen.
Frozen's
was
great.
So freaking good. And it kind of just like faded away into nothing. Nobody talks about it. I never see it on TV. I love that movie. It really freaks me out.
Let me chuck one more in there. Prince of Darkness, a John Carpenter film that is overlooked by, you know, a lot of people talk about Halloween or Escape from New York or The Thing. Prince of Darkness is a really underrated John Carpenter film, especially just because of the tone that it has. It just has this really creepy tone throughout the entire film, and this dread, which just keeps going, getting more and more until it gets to the end.
I'd also add Lake Mungo. I don't know if you guys have seen that, but it's an Australian sort of faux documentary. But what's great about it is that it actually feels real. Now, they're not trying to trick you. This isn't like Blair Witch Project part, you know, where they want you to think it's actually real. It's definitely not a real movie, but there's something, you think you know where it's going, and then, whoop, it's not going there, and then it takes another twist, and these actors, they feel so, they feel like real people. It's just really a cool film. I saw it, it was on TV one day, and I was kind of half watching it, and then it was one of those where I sat down and I finished it, and I was like, that was great. So I really like that one. And speaking of Michael Rooker, Slither.
Oh, yeah.
Great. If you Good guys call. Love you some James Gunn, yeah. you gotta watch Slither. It's such a great movie, and it's a little movie, but gets the job done, and it's a fun, gross horror comedy. Speaking of body horror, bring it all around.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that's it for us today, guys.
Thank you
all so much for watching us here on Wednesdays. We're going to be on Wednesdays from now on. So find us here. And thank you to the panel. Perri, where can everybody find you?
You guys can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNMROF. Collider Nightmares every Wednesday. Don't forget, tell your friends, all that good stuff. We also have Best of the Week every Saturday. And then a double dose of recap shows Sunday night. It's Ash versus Evil Dead and The Walking Dead recap shows. Go check those out too.
And
that
Mr.
was in English.
we got the idea. Thanks. And Mr. John Schnepp.
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram, just at John Schnepp, on Collider Heroes, which was yesterday, Collider Nightmares on Wednesday, and middle of the week on Movie Talk. And definitely this weekend coming up, DesignerCon in Pasadena. I'll be there, booth 804. Come on by and check out my Unicrom, the Unicorn Barbarian. We can pre-order that right now. November 19th, 20th, Pasadena. Check it out, DesignerCon.
Nice. And to my right, Mr. Mark Reilly.
You can find me at Reilly Around on Twitter and Instagram. I'll be on the Schmoes Domain Show every Thursdays at 7. I'll do Sunday Mailbag, and I'll be back on Collider Nightmares.
And Mark Reilly and I had a team match, Wolves of Steel.
Oh, yeah. I forgot.
We took on our the real rejects in the Schmodown.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you know, I don't want to say, but it was a real nail biter.
It was. That was a nail biter.
Yeah. So check that out right here on Collider Video.
Yeah.
That was a close one.
Yeah, I'm still sweating over that one.
Yeah, but did we win or lose? Who knows?
I don't know.
Guess you're just going to have to watch.
Yeah, you're going to have to watch it.
And you can find me at Clarke Wolfe, Clarke with an E, Wolf with an E on the internet. If you like this show, please tell your friends. Please subscribe and give us the thumbs up and add it to playlists and all that fun stuff. And don't forget to watch Movie Talk tomorrow morning. That's it for now. And until next time, we will see you in your nightmares.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.